Hello, and welcome to Prairie Pulse. Joining us today is the executive director of the Fargo Theater, Emily Beck. Emily, thanks so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
Well, obviously, you're here to talk about the upcoming Fargo Film Festival, but before we do that, tell the folks a little bit about yourself and your background, maybe where you're originally from.
Sure. Well, I was born in Fargo, raised in Valley City, North Dakota. I came back to the Fargo-Moorhead community in 2001 to study film at Minnesota State University, Moorhead. Following graduation, I worked for the Marcus Theaters Corporation and kind of biding my time, so hopefully someday I could get a job at the Fargo Theater. Fortunately enough, that opportunity came in 2008, and I've been with the organization in one capacity or another since then.
Well, so you've been involved and obviously taken over from Margie Bailey. So what's that been like?
Well, I was fortunate enough to actually work with Margie for 3 years, and during those 3 years, she actually had taken me under her wing and was sort of secretly grooming me to take over. I didn't realize, but that apparently had been the intention with my hire to begin with. So I had the opportunity to learn a great deal from that incredible woman. And now it's been just over 3 years that I've been in this position, so I think I'm starting to kind of get the feel down and really try to make the organization mine as much as I can for the community.
Well, let's turn to the film festival. Mm-hmm. First off, when is it?
The festival will run March 3rd through the 7th at the Fargo Theater.
Okay. And with that said, let's talk about how many films were entered this year and, you know, how many were selected, I guess.
Well, we have seen some pretty tremendous growth in the last few years. This is our 15th annual festival, which we're pretty excited about. A lot of young festivals don't make the 15 mark, so we are very grateful to the community for embracing us and for allowing us to actually make this little milestone. In the last 3 years, we've actually tripled our submission numbers. This year we received 330 films, and 95 of them were selected to screen.
Wow, that's okay. It sounds like quite a few. Well, let's talk about, I mean, work of the volunteers who serve as sort of the jurors, you call them, and the ones that do other tasks also.
Absolutely. The Fargo Film Festival is a volunteer-driven event. We have a team of more than 50 volunteers that give countless hours to make this happen. So the volunteers work in juries. Yeah, the 330 films are actually judged by the category in which they are submitted. So whether that be a documentary or an experimental film, they're judged individually by their category by a jury of anywhere, I'd say, from 9 to, our larger juries are about 15 people. So they judge the films, they judge all the submissions, and they decide what's going to be included and what doesn't quite make the mark. The volunteers are also very instrumental the week of the festival and the weeks leading up as far as everything from publicity to filmmaker hospitality. When we have guests that come here from all over the world, these volunteers are critical for making them feel welcome, making sure they have everything they need at their hotel, showing them around the city, and just really giving them that warm Fargo welcome.
Well, you mentioned you've seen submissions increase over the last 2 or 3 years. Why is that?
Well, I believe submissions have increased so substantially because the Fargo Film Festival has actually gone online. In the last few years, we have taken our submissions through two online submission clearinghouse platforms, basically. Without a Box and Film Freeway are the two largest festival submission platforms online, and they're used by a lot of the major festivals all over the world. It allows filmmakers to log onto a site and to submit to many different festivals all at once. And I think the Fargo Film Festival joining these has really been a big step forward for us.
Okay, well, sure. Well, I know it may be a little early as we're recording this interview today to know who might be coming, but I assume some of the winning filmmakers will be there.
Absolutely. You know, last year we were fortunate to have more than 30 filmmakers and actors and producers join us for the festival. This year we're hoping to top that. Of course, as you said, at the time of filming, we're not entirely sure who that's going to be, but invitations have been sent out literally to filmmakers, actors, producers from all over the world. And we're really hoping it'll be another just all-star lineup again this year.
Well, with that said, any insight to special guests, or is it too early to tell?
I am sorry, but we're working on a few things behind the scenes, but it would be too early to announce any of that yet.
Wow. Okay. I know you have establishments in the city that help with pre-parties and even post-parties, and you may want to mention a few of those. I don't know if you need any thank yous to go out to them.
Oh, absolutely. You know, parties are a huge part of the festival experience, no matter where you go. For a smaller festival like the Fargo to, you know, the big festivals like Sundance and Cannes, parties are part of the experience. It's a way for us to truly meet and interact with these filmmakers and guests from all over the world and to celebrate their work, as well as just get together with fellow film lovers and have wonderful conversations. So the parties continue to be a big part of the Fargo Film Festival experience. We've been very grateful in the past to have organizations like the Hotel Donaldson and Mezzaluna and Beefsteak and wonderful downtown restaurants and bars welcome us for these special parties, and I think they really make it a first-class event.
Okay, well, let's talk about maybe the impact of, you know, Fargo Theater added a second screen in what year was that?
Well, it was opened in the middle of 2009, so the first festival that we had the second screen would have been 2010.
Okay, and what impact then has that had for the festival?
Oh, it's been absolutely wonderful for the Fargo Film Festival. In past years, we had to kind of search around the community to find basically an empty space where we could set up shop for our second screening room. This has allowed us to keep everything really central and focused at the Fargo Theater. And it's also been wonderful for our guests because it makes it so convenient. There will always be films playing in both auditoriums at any given time throughout the festival. And our guests can look at the program guide and they can say, well, maybe I'm going to start the afternoon in the main auditorium and see a documentary, but then there's this animated comedy that looks great, so maybe I can hop between screens. And it really allows them to create their own program and see what they want to see.
Interesting there. Have you tried to sort of put your own stamp, your own fingerprints on the festival, basically taking over from Margie?
Well, I think I've tried to some extent. Like I said, I really couldn't have asked for a better mentor than Margie, and she certainly taught me a lot. But of course, you know, you take over a position and you kind of want to make something your own as much as you can. So from simple things like selecting the original piece of artwork that we use every year, the festival coordinates with a local artist and we select an original piece of art to represent that year's festival. So everything from working with those artists to actually taking us to the online platforms, those are small ways that I've kind of tried to make my own mark.
Well, and I should have said, congratulations on 15 years.
Oh.
Obviously, the passion Margie had and you continue with have been a big part of that. I don't doubt that at all. So let's turn to the festival and talk about some of the winning and selected films. Of course, you had a very strong documentary feature category.
Oh, absolutely. The documentary feature category this year, I think, is just world class. And it has a great deal of variety. Everything from there's a documentary about the life of the man that's played Big Bird for the last 40-odd years to a documentary about people that are involved in competitive jigsaw puzzling. And then there's a film that I'm just extremely proud that we're going to be sharing with this community. And it's a film that premiered at Sundance and won a special award. It's currently in distribution, and it's actually on the Academy Awards shortlist right now. It's a film called The Overnighters. And it's a remarkable documentary feature that was actually shot in Western North Dakota. So it was shot in a small community out there. And of course, it deals with the issues that they're facing with the oil boom. So all the workers that are coming to this community, and it really focuses on one pastor and his family and their efforts to make sure that these people have some place to sleep, some place that's safe. And then of course, all the challenges that they face in doing that, because the community is not necessarily extremely excited about them embracing these men. So it is a remarkable picture, and we are so fortunate to have it with the Fargo Film Festival.
Hmm. Now, we're going to talk about other categories, but out of 330 films submitted, I mean, where are all these filmmakers from?
All over the world, absolutely all over. We do get a handful from North Dakota, and I would say definitely from Minnesota as well. But actually, we saw a large number of submissions from Australia, New Zealand, and then also from the UK this year. So when I say all over, I mean all over.
All right. I understand the narrative feature had 9 very good films. And can you talk about these?
Absolutely. The winning film is a British science fiction love story called Frequencies, that I think is just dynamic and really well written and really interesting. So if you're a sci-fi fan, don't miss that one. There's a comedy called Pregoland starring James Caan, which is adorable and just highly entertaining. And this year we're actually another first for the Fargo Film Festival. We're showing a new silent feature film. So it's an entirely silent film, and it will actually be screened with a live score on the Mighty Wurlitzer Theater pipe organ at the theaters. So it was actually made by a group of young filmmakers based in the Minneapolis area, and it was their dream to make a silent feature, so they did, and now it's going to be screened as a part of our festival. It's a wonderful story.
Interesting. Narrative shorts always seem to be a strong category. How about those?
I would say narrative short tends to be the audience favorite. It's a format that we love, but that we don't see in movie theaters that often. So it's always really entertaining to see a 10 or 15 minute film that tells a wonderful story and is able to give us these incredible characters and able to move us in such a short period of time. So narrative short, again, comedies, dramas, and then actually this year, we didn't plan it this way, but it just sort of happened that there's a bit of an emphasis on films about astronauts. So we'll see several films in the narrative short category that are in space.
Interesting. Well, I understand you feel the student category may be the strongest it's ever been.
I really do feel that way. Because we moved the festival onto these online submission platforms, we have seen such an increase in student film submissions from all over the world. And our winner is actually a Chinese film called Carry On that is currently also on the Oscar shortlist. So if our student winner is competing with some of the top short films in the world, I think we're pretty proud about the growth we've seen in that arena. We received over 55 student submissions, and just 10 were selected to screen. So this is really the best of the best. And it also includes one local student film with some special effects that are just out of this world. They're just incredible. It's actually a music video, but some of the actual physical special effects that they did will just knock your socks off.
All right, so you said that was on the Oscar shortlist, but also I understand that animation has an Oscar contender as the winner as well.
That's correct. We have three films in the festival this year: The Overnighters, the student winner Carry On, and then the animation winner Coda, which is an Irish film. It's quite short. It's about 6 minutes long. But holy cow, if it doesn't just take your breath away. This film is gorgeous, it's meditative, it's everything you could ask for.
And documentary shorts, what about that category?
Again, we've seen great growth with this category, and the winner this year, I remember watching it after it had been selected, and it's one of those films where you actually start speaking back to the film, you're so moved by it. It focuses on a 24-year-old journalist in Syria, this young woman who basically she looks right at the camera at the beginning of the film and says, "I'm not sure if I'll be alive to finish this film, but somebody needs to know what's going on here." And it follows her through this, the streets during the uprising in Syria. So, incredible film.
Well, what about experimental?
Experimental is probably the category that we have to answer the most questions about.
What is experimental? Experimental.
Well, we leave that up to the filmmakers to decide if their films should be considered as an experimental film. But typically that means it's non-narrative. It doesn't necessarily tell a story, but watching it is meant to elicit some sort of emotional response and meant to call up that emotional feeling in its audience. So I always compare it to going to a museum and looking at paintings or listening to incredible music, and it's often all of these things combined. They use sound and image to really evoke that emotional response. So most of the experimental films are quite short, and people are often surprised at how much they're actually be able to move by something that isn't narrative, that isn't telling a story. And I love hearing our audience reactions after maybe they've seen their first experimental film. It's quite remarkable.
And so this category, did you tell us the winner? Or?
The winner is a 6 minute film from the States called Confluence, and it's basically focuses on the fact that everything is in constant motion. If you look down to the very deepest elements of what we're comprised of, everything is constantly in motion. So it studies that theory in a very non-narrative sort of way.
Well, as we're coming up on this year's festival, if people want to come and experience it, what would you suggest?
I would recommend taking a look at our program guide, which is available on fargotheater.org, reading about these incredible films and figuring out what would be to your taste, reading about our special guests, seeing perhaps if there's a question and answer session or a lunch and panel discussion that really intrigues you. We have everything from passes that cover all screenings, all parties, all panel discussions, and people are certainly welcome to just come to one evening showcase or one afternoon worth of films. We try to keep the prices as affordable as possible, so for $6 you can come and see an entire afternoon's worth of film programming.
Well, that's very reasonable. But the point I was trying to make is you say that it goes from the 3rd through the...
The 7th.
7th, 3rd through the 7th. Doesn't mean you have to be there for the entire festival to enjoy it.
Goodness, no. You know, some people do. They say they always take their vacation over the festival and they come for the full week and see everything. But quite frequently, people will just come one afternoon or one evening. They'll find what appeals to them, and you're certainly welcome to do that. And that might be the best way to start with the film festival if you've never been.
Okay. Well, I understand you're expanding this year by starting to show films on Tuesday afternoon, March the 3rd this year. Why are you doing that?
Just simply to allow our audiences more opportunity. We've grown so much. And in past years, we've had some incredible films that have only been able to screen one time. So we wanted to increase the show times for some of our winning films and give audiences that extra opportunity to see them.
Okay. And with that said, this is now setting it up for next year. When do you actually begin process of planning the Fargo Film Festival?
Well, we typically begin a few weeks after the previous one ends. We'll wrap things up from one year, and then we'll start taking submissions online for the next festival just a few weeks after. By mid-March, we'll be open for submissions.
So this is an ongoing, year-long type, almost. not a lot of activity maybe in April, May, but then it builds as it goes.
It is a year-long endeavor for our Fargo Theater staff, as well as for our volunteer team. They start screening those submissions late spring, early summer.
They screen them that early. Okay,
absolutely. Well,
I would have never thought about that. Well, okay, if people want to get tickets, where can they go? What can they do?
Tickets are available at the Fargo Theater box office starting a week before the festival. And the theater staff there are always really happy to help people figure out our different pass system and what pass might be best for their needs.
Mm-hmm. Well, Emily, what are sort of your goals? I mean, you've said it's been successful. I think in big part to the people that have led the festival, to the city buying into it, so to speak. Your submissions have grown. But so now, what are the plans for the next 15 years? We won't go that far. What are the plans for the next few years for the festival?
Well, ideally, one of our large long-term goals would be to make the Fargo Film Festival an Academy Awards qualifying festival. Now, we have a ways to go to reach that mark, but we're going to keep working. And if we keep growing at this rate, I do believe that is a goal we could reach.
Really?
Absolutely,
What are the qualifications, or can you explain that in a brief term of what do you have to do to be an Academy Award qualified festival? I guess I got all that out.
Yeah, absolutely. You have to prove basically that you're a significant, well-functioning festival. We need to get a few more years under our belt, but then there's a whole bunch of rules and regulations about that. But if we meet those qualifications, we would really make the festival an appealing festival to the top filmmakers, because then simply screening at our festival would make them eligible to be nominated for an Academy Award. So that would be a long-term goal for the Fargo Film Festival. For now, we just want to continue this incremental growth. We'll keep focusing on our online submission platforms, and we'll continue to grow our volunteer team as well.
Well, with that said, could you do this without the volunteers?
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. This is a volunteer-driven festival. They put in countless hours, viewing hundreds of hours of material. There's just absolutely no way we could do it without these incredible people who are so generous with their time and talents.
Okay. Well, Emily, before you go away, I understand you brought some film clips for us to see.
I did,
so,
absolutely.
Let's now take a look at some clips from the 7 winning films at this year's Fargo Film Festival.
Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, early in the morning, gentlemen. Holy, holy, holy. Lord, good morning, Brandon. Lord God Almighty. Morning, Robert. Early in the morning, our song shall rise to thee. Morning, gentlemen. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons.
Good morning, guys. Good morning.
I have to do this for my country. I have to give what I can give. It's pretty important to let the world see what's going on. You know, I think nobody knew Syria, even on the map, before this revolution, and now everybody knows what's going on in Syria, and that's because of the press covering what's going on. That's really important. Somebody has to see all this. Somebody has to know what this monster is doing to us and to his own people. And I'm making sure that somebody's gonna know. All the people in the world are going to see this, hopefully.
It should be, but there are no guarantees.
That's it?
The main part. It might not work.
I've decided you can talk if you want.
Thanks. It's weird talking to you without a deadline. Or not talking.
Tell me about where you live, Alvaro.
I live in the city of Syracuse. It's a very pretty city, and I have a little house on the hill with a view of the city and the sea. And I have a little garden, and sometimes I just like to sit there and drink of wine and look out to the beautiful sea. I love the sea. Always make me feel very free, you know?
ありません。報告します。食料はありますが、とても少ないです。人はまだ誰もいません。なんだと？どういうことだ？大丈夫。
Don't you stare to me now. No drinks outside, please.
Cheers. Good night. I'm going home.
I think it better.
Yeah, okay, I'm gone, gone, gone.
Just need a fire for 3 more.
Hey!
I'm all right, I'm gone.
Be careful there.
Come on.
Thank you.
Well, some great looking films there. Congratulations on 15 years again. But real quick, if people want more information, where can they go?
FargoFilmFestival.com will answer all of their questions.
Well, Emily, best of luck to you.
Thank you.
Well, that's all we have on Prairie Pulse this week. And as always, thanks for watching.